Hello and greetings, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Jamie's Journeys. Now, today, I am in northwestern Peru, and I left from the port city of Salaverry. Now, there's nothing really to see in Salaverry, and I've come now a short distance to the city of Trujillo. Now, this is the second most populous city in all of Peru, and it was named after Francisco Pizarro. That was actually, Trujillo was his birthplace in Spain, and Francisco Pizarro came here in 1532. And since then, this city has now taken on the name, the city or the capital of the eternal spring, but since then, it has become known as the capital city for culture in all of Peru, and that's what brings us here today. So it's time to get started. Thanks for joining me on another Jamie's Journey. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to our guide for today, and this lady is an anthropologist. She's a storyteller. She is an expert on South American culture and history, and this is Terry Breen. Terry, well, great to be with you today.
It's my pleasure to welcome you to the City of Culture, because indeed, there's a lot to discover here in the northern part of Peru in Trujillo.
Yeah, so we're going to visit a couple different sites today, aren't we?
We're going to be not only visiting a couple of different sites, but we're going to be spanning a couple thousand years of time and history in this very limited amount of space here around the city, and so lots to see and do.
Yeah. Now we're getting started, as we said, in the city of Trujillo.
Right.
We're here at the main square. Can you tell us about the square and a little bit about the city?
Well, as you already know, that Trujillo is the oldest city, second oldest city in Peru, and so there's a lot of history in all the buildings that surround us. These are some of the finest examples of Spanish colonial architecture in the country, and just peeking inside some of these little interior courtyards, you can see all of the beautiful wrought iron work and the wonderful ceramics and tiles, and it's all been very beautifully restored, and so it's really a colonial gem. But the Plaza de Armas itself was part of that grid pattern that the Spanish used throughout all of Latin America, where the important buildings like the cathedral, the administrative buildings, the governor's palace, was all located here. And if there was any type of attack or there was a threat to the city, there would be a call to arms. Mm-hmm. And so everybody came here to the Plaza de Armas to get munitions to defend the city.
Now, do the wealthy want to live closest to that for some reason? Because all the nicest dwellings, at least, seem to be here.
Actually, yeah. The closer you would be to that protection, the better off you would be. And so if you had all of the other people that were with less status, that were living around you, kind of provided a little bit more of a protection. So a little bit of a buffer between the outside world and this inner sanctum around the central part of town. And it really is a beautiful area with lots of fountains and beautiful plantings, gardens, mm-hmm. and this.
It really is a beautiful spot.
It's very nice.
Now, I even got a question. I kind of ran out this morning. I didn't really get some nourishment for today. Mm. Do you have any ideas?
Actually, I have just the thing.
Yeah?
Yeah, let's go look. I got an idea.
Thank you.
Okay, Jamie, this is our snack, and this is something
this
that...
This is food for the day, you hear me?
This weighs about a half a pound, and it's something that is special that they make here in Trujillo. And actually, my friends in Lima would always say, if you're going to Trujillo, please bring us back King Kong's.
Now, that's excess baggage, I think.
Well, in
King Kong's.
In all parts of South America, they make this little cookie that is filled with either jams or chocolate and other things. And usually they're about the size of a standard cookie.
Uh-huh.
And they're called alfajores. But here they make these gigantic ones and they call them King Kongs. And you can see it looks like something that King Kong would snack on.
I take it you don't normally go like that, do you? No.
I guarantee you that it'll just go and squish all out.
I probably normally eat this with a knife, but...
You can probably take...
Anyway, I'll give it a go. Do you want to taste first?
No, I'm okay.
So this is what the...
That one is jam. It says that's... Oh my gosh, it's pineapple jam.
You did it to me again.
I didn't choose it specifically.
Okay. So pineapple jam and...
And that's manjar. And so...
Manjar.
Manjar is like a milk-based caramel, and then looks like there's some raisins in there. You might want to go for the middle part first if you want to avoid.
Now, how am I going to do that?
We could rip it apart.
Well, I think I'll start at the bottom.
Okay. It's filling. It's like eating peanut butter. It's
chewy.
It's hard to speak afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
You do need something to wash that down.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we can find something.
But I like it.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's plenty of it.
I didn't even get to the middle part yet.
Well, it'll take you a while.
I like it.
Good. Well, that might be able to tide you over as we make our way out to Chan Chan.
That's right. We got to get going.
Okay, let's go.
All right. We'll eat this on the run. Come on. Let's go. That's good.
It's big.
Oh my gosh.
It's bigger than
all right. Now we're going to get a taxi to go to a place called Chan Chan. We're going to talk to you about that in a minute. But first here, in this square especially, you see these very unique balconies. What are they? Why are they designed like that?
Well, you can see they almost look like little cages. That's a real typical Moorish design. And at the time that the city was constructed, you think about Spain and the Iberian Peninsula was occupied for 700 years by the Moors, and so they very heavily influenced them in their architecture. And these kinds of enclosed balconies were ways that families had of being able to enjoy a little bit of fresh air without being seen by the outside world. But many times, families would build these balconies out across the street so that they would almost be touching one another. And if they had maybe a girl that was of the age when she started to become interested in boys, and maybe they had a boy on the other side of the street, they could sort of line them out up and they could court through these balconies without getting...
I get it.
Yeah. So that was something you see all throughout the colonial portions of Trujillo.
Yeah. Beautiful design. Very nice. All right. Well, let's get a taxi. Finished my King Kong, so I don't think I have to eat for the next week.
pretty filling.
Now I know why it is a King Kong. That was good. Hey, anyway, where are we now?
Right now we are in the site of Chan Chan, which is the largest adobe city in the world. And to date, this is the capital of the Chimú culture. And we're in one of the precincts. And this particular district was built around a temple, or a waka, that's what they're called here. It's called the waka of the rainbow, the arco iris.
And that's spelled H-U-A-C-A
is waka. Yeah, and so all the designs on the outside of this structure have the rainbow, and then it frames in some of the motifs that were important to the people, like fish and pelicans and other things that you'd see here along the coast.
Mm-hmm.
So sort of like the tree of life. It's symbolize there.
So that's the rainbow.
Right, arco iris.
And you see, so you'll see that all, as we go through.
All in this particular precinct, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, the Chimu.
Mm-hmm.
The Chimu, they were not the first civilization here, were they? They're really the second, or kind of the third, right?
Maybe about the third. Mm-hmm. The Moche were the first great civilization in this area. And they settled along the rivers coming down from the Andes, flowing to the sea. And they had a very large agricultural society. And they were around for about 600, 700 years. And then they started to sort of die out, or conquered by another group that came down from the mountains. And then the Chimu came in probably around 1100 A.D.
Yeah. And so they made these structures. I understand there's about 10,000 structures.
Yeah, yeah.
In the whole area.
It's you know, as we were driving through Trujillo, everywhere you look, we're going through residential areas and commercial areas of the present day city, and then all of a sudden in the middle there's something like this, because all this area was inhabited and it was all under cultivation, and it looked very, very different at the time when this was the capital city. And so you can see all the structure, as well as even the way that it was made. This is all adobe.
So it's like several different platforms here, and that is the adobe. That is, what's that made out of?
It's clay, sand, and straw. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways that archaeologists have for being able to date these structures is by carbon dating the straw used in the adobe. And sometimes These were very beautifully created bricks for making the walls and the huacas, but in some areas they actually put the adobe into baskets and then just piled the baskets up. And many times when they would pull the basket off, little fibers from the basket would remain, or sometimes the entire basket, and you can carbon date that. And so it gets you a really good idea of exactly when the people were living here.
All right, well, let's go on in. All those bricks, ladies. Inside now, and this is a fantastic wall, and this is the real thing, right? This is not redone.
No, this would have been excavated out, and you can see that where we were before, there was an exterior wall that enclosed this courtyard, and then there is one entry, so there's limited access, and then as you come in, there were ramps that went up to the top of the main portion of the temple, or the huaca, which is this interior core, so this has all of the nice relief on it.
And it's a lot of symbolism here. You see, first off, you see like this fella here. This was like a warrior.
Mm-hmm.
He had, sorry?
No, I was going to say there's warriors up here on the top, too. You can see with the staff and the knife.
Yeah. So, but he was like, he had someone's head.
Yeah, he's got
a knife.
He's got a tumi. So the tumi is that sort of a semicircular knife blade. It almost looks like an Alaskan ulu.
Yeah.
And then in his other hand, he has a trophy head. And so it shows that he's been a victorious warrior or soldier. And he's taken a captive. And many times you see that as a sign of prosperity, strength, and power. Mm-hmm. But you also see all of the wealth of the land between the rainbow, and then you see the waves on the top, and then you see all of the bounty that comes from the sea. See the fish, we were looking, and what looked like little shrimp over here, and then all the birds, there's pelicans in other places. And so, and again, this is another one of those tumis, that semicircular knife in the mouth of sea creatures.
So the waters off here are normally full of shrimp, crustaceans, fish. Due to what's called the Humboldt Current, right, which is the water current from the
Antarctica. Yeah. So it's coming from the south, and it's a cold water current.
Yeah.
And even though we are fairly equatorial here, it's not tropical. Right now, the sun has come through.
It's feeling more equatorial by the clouds
are burning off, but normally around here, it's a lot cooler than it would be at comparable latitudes, and the terrain here all along the coast is arid, just like this. It's like a big desert. And if you were to go swimming in the ocean here, you would have a brisk little dip, because it's quite cold. And in Lima, surfing is really popular here now, and people will go out in dry suits because it's so cold to go surfing.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, let's go up the raft and see what the top looks like.
Yeah.
They have these wonderful ramps instead of stairs.
I mean, yeah.
But considering how old these are, you know, it's amazing, the smoothness of them. Anyway, we're up here now. This was really a place of worship, wasn't it?
And the communities
surrounded it. Yeah.
And many archaeologists say that this idea of mound building was a way for man to try to replicate nature. Mm-hmm. And when you look around and you see the mountains that sort of rise up and flatten out, they look similar to the way that these huacas were constructed.
Yeah, so this is Cerro Blanco.
Cerro Blanco.
Cerro Blanco. Cerro Blanco is a girl. Cerro Blanco. And that is the White Mountain.
Yeah.
And you can see that, I mean, this is just arid country. I mean, they said two streams that kind of ran down from the Andes.
Right, yeah.
And that is really what made the lush part of it. But other than that, they say they would normally get about less than an inch of rainfall a year.
Right.
Normally.
In pre-Columbian times, they diverted whatever they could from the mountains and irrigated this whole area.
Mm-hmm.
And during the whole colonial time, this has been dry, dry, dry. And when archaeologists started to see that this area had been under cultivation, they thought, well, couldn't we do this again? And they actually turned to Israeli agronomists to learn how to make the desert bloom.
Mm-hmm. Which they did very well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So as we look out from here, you can see maybe some other sites or two that...
In fact, you can see one over there on the horizon. Mm-hmm.
But what I do like is that they have these metal pole structures, because one of the problems with this area is because they've had changing weather patterns, they either get long periods of dry or long periods of wet, and the wet has been turning some of the bricks to mud, right?
Exactly. And with the exposure, where before, when this would have been unexcavated, then it would be a little bit protected, but now it's all exposed, and they can just drop tarps and canvas over the top of all of the relief to keep it shielded from the rain.
Yeah.
So it's a good thing.
Mm-hmm. All right. Quite interesting, and a beautiful sight. All right, carry on.
That one, you can see that where we were before.
Yeah.
But it is. I mean.
All right, Terry, now you've had a stop at a service station, a gas station. What's up?
It's one of my favorite places in Trujillo.
Yeah?
This gas station.
Okay, why?
This is one of the secret places in the city. There is actually a privately owned museum that is underneath the gas station.
Really?
You will not believe it. We've got to go check this out, because this belongs to the Casinelli family. And there are things here that are one of a kind. It's one of the best private collections in the country under a gas station.
Who would have known? Okay. Oh, there it is right there, Museo Arqueologico. Okay, Terry, we're inside now. Mr. Cassinelli, who just passed away.
Right. We were just told he's 92 years old. Mm-hmm. And so he was the one that, he comes from a long family, a long line of people that have lived here in Trujillo for many years, very prosperous family. And I knew of him when he owned several gas stations and also owned a plumbing supply company, and there were other businesses he was involved in, but all of this got started because of his family, his parents, that had started to pick up different artifacts that were on their properties around the city, and then eventually when people started hearing that they were collectors, they would bring them things. And I can actually remember when the entrance to this museum was outside, and you went down those stairs, and there used to be those big plastic buckets, and they'd be filled with pots, and they'd be soaking in water and sometimes gasoline to try to remove all the debris from them. So everything down there is the real thing. These aren't imitations, and there are pieces there that you will not find in any other place. They are exquisite, and it can't accommodate large groups. Nobody really knows about this place, and downstairs the display area is just shelves that are contained by fishing lines.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
All right, so I think these are just a few of the artifacts, right, on display?
Right.
Wow. All right, then we'll come down to the beach area. This is called Huanchaco.
Huanchaco, right.
Beautiful. It's a nice spot. Lots of people just hanging out on the beach. And then you have these reed boats.
Right, Totora reed boats. And they're called caballitos. And we're really lucky to see that these guys are actually using them, paddling out there. And they historically have been used for fishing. And they would either be kneeling on them in that little indentation or straddling them and then throwing their nets out. You can even see in some of the old chimu and moche pots that the caballitos and the fishermen are still shown on those ancient ceramics. And here they're alive and well in Huanchaco. And this little community has really become very, very popular and quite international. And there's lots of new apartments and looks like hotels and backpackers and all kinds of people from all over the world here.
Lovely atmosphere, for sure. So now the paddles for those, there doesn't seem like much.
It was just a split piece of bamboo.
Yeah.
So they just opened that up and would use that.
So we debated taking a ride, but...
Not dressed.
I think you'll get a little wet, more wet than our taxi driver would probably like for me to be sitting in the car. But it was tempting out there, so that's lovely. So these are all around, so you can take a ride if you bring your swimsuit.
Yeah.
Or if you find a taxi driver that doesn't care if you're wet, you can do that too.
Yeah, that'd be good.
All right. Well, glad we came down here. So pretty.
It is.
So we wanted to get a closer look at these, and the paddle, again, that's just a
split bamboo.
Bamboo. Now these are not authentic in a way that they've got styrofoam in them. So
yeah, these are cheaters.
Little cheaters, but it reminded me of the Thor Heyerdahl.
Right. Well, you know, Heyerdahl wasn't, a lot of people remember him from the Kon-Tiki expedition and think about him being an explorer or an adventurer. He actually was a biologist, and he got interested in how the sweet potato, which is a staple in Polynesia, was introduced there, because it's actually endemic to South America, and it doesn't float. So it would have had to have been physically transported So how did it get there? So he came to the coast of South America, and he saw that here in this part of Peru, the people for centuries have been using these totora reed boats. Then also, very similar design is used up in Lake Titicaca. Mm-hmm. So he said maybe it would have been possible for them to construct boats that would have been seaworthy so that they would have been the ones to introduce the sweet potato to Polynesia. Mm-hmm. And he constructed Kontiki out of the same materials to try to prove his hypothesis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Seems to work. Very interesting, though. Should have brought the bathing suit.
Next time. Oh, well.
All right, we've now come to the last stop on today's journey, and I'm going to let Terry say where we are because she can say it a lot better. Where are we, Terry?
Right now we're in the Huaca del Sol, so the temple to the sun. And this was the center of the ceremonial center of the capital of the Moche Empire. And so this is like one of the first major civilizations, not just in northern Peru, but in all of Peru. And this was one of the holy of holies, and it's located right at the base of the sacred mountain.
And so the temple is owned by the Moches. Again, so that goes back to the earliest civilization, known civilization here. And that could be as much as 1,000 BC or so, right?
Yeah, right, 1,100 BC, and they continued even to about a couple hundred years after Christ. Mm-hmm. And so this was a really long period of time of occupation here. And it wasn't just along the Moche River, which is one of the main rivers flowing down from the Andes. They had settlements on all of the arable riverbanks along the coast. And so big population.
I think the Moche civilization started in southern Ecuador and ran to mid-Peru, about 600 miles.
Yeah, that would be about right, yeah.
And the plains, about the narrowest 20 miles from the mountains to about 100 miles, so it's really quite an expanse.
Right, and they were very expansionistic and militaristic, because not only were they trying to expand their territory, but in their conquest they were taking captives, and the captives would be used as an exercise of their power for sacrifice or for enslavement. And you can even see here in this temple that as they started to grow more and more powerful, that there were successive layers that were built upon the temple or the Huaca. And some of the excavation that's taking place here show some of those older layers that were filled in and then amplified with a new layer, and there are different styles and different types of techniques, artistic techniques and motifs. And here you see some more of that color that mm-hmm. you usually associate with some of the frescoes. And this is fascinating what we're looking at mm-hmm. here, because we were just checking this out. Where we are standing right now would have been the top layer of the last construction of the Huaca. And all along the outside was a wall, and the wall of this patio, this open patio that would be framing up the sacred mountain directly behind, has images of the mountain god on them. And what we're looking at down here is actually what was the older patio. It's a little bit smaller, and so when they wanted to build this structure, they had to fill in that patio, almost like mm-hmm. filling in a big swimming pool, mm-hmm. leveling it off, and then building the new walls around it.
Mm-hmm. And so covering some of the old walls, as we can see here, it was covered up as they built up on it.
Right, and there's probably several other layers below that, too, that haven't been excavated.
And may very well be preserved just because they've been protected.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's one of the things that's always exciting, not only about archaeology in general, when you can have a layer that's been almost mummified like that, but in this arid environment, it doesn't start to deteriorate that much because of you don't have a lot of humidity here, and there's obviously not a lot of rain, but very, very different. So this is, they've done a lot of work here. This is exciting. I want to go see all of the rest of the things that there are here.
Let's carry on.
Okay.
Million blocks have gone into making this huaca. And how do you know who created the adobe bricks, and how do they get paid? Well, they got paid in a genius way. Each of these bricks has an identifying mark on it. As you can see, there are many different manufacturers, and you can still see them on the bricks today. For the, it could be an X, it could be a, there's a cross here, there's a slash here, slash there, different kind of design there. And all these are maker's marks so that they know whose bricks are whose and where they came from. Behind us now you see the fertile Moche Valley, and then the pyramid of Huaca de la Luna.
Exactly.
Did I say that right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Now that is the tallest pyramid, adobe pyramid, in the Americas.
Right. There are other pyramids that were taller, but not made of solid adobe brick like that one.
And that one measures even today 135 feet tall, 1,250 feet long, and I imagine it was at one time even taller.
Even taller, and even probably wider at the base.
Yeah. Now, when the Spaniards came in like 1602, especially, there was some serious grave robbing going on, and they cut away a good part of that, thinking that maybe inside there was treasure.
There probably was.
They're always looking for treasure, and they didn't find any there. But that went over 50 million bricks, if you can imagine that.
What I think is amazing is that for years and years, the emphasis was always on the two huacas. And, you know, archaeologically, we've known that the valley supported a large population, but nobody had been going and excavating any of the settlements or the habitation of the normal people, the regular people. And they're starting to do that now. And there you can see that this whole area is just filled with the foundations of houses and palaces and markets and everything that you would expect in a large, complex urban area like this, the capital of a very, very large civilization.
And these people are really known to be great city planners, weren't they, and social planners?
Absolutely. Well, they were, the Moche were the ones that were a little bit more expansionistic and sort of started to massage some of the things that later would be capitalized on by other cultures, like the Inca, that learned a lot from the Moche, which were ancient ancestors by the time that the Inca came around. But you can just see what the engineering and the irrigation that took place here, it's phenomenal that they made this place bloom.
Yeah. All right. Well, we're running out of time, so we're going to start to make our way down. Behind us, there's an area where they found the remains of many people who were sacrificed. And Terry, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, this area was, nobody really knew exactly the extent to which sacrifices took place here. We knew about the trophy heads and about captives that were taken because of the militarism of the Moche. But this area had experienced a really bad period of flooding and rains that came from an El Nino. And during that time, there was damage that took place here to the Huaca, and some of these interior patios started to wash away. And when they did, they found that there were scores and scores of skeletons. And they weren't just skeletons, they were mangled, decapitated skeletons. And so they started looking at what had taken place there, and there'd always been stories that even in some of the pottery where you see the drawings of people that were being paraded into a central courtyard and being sacrificed. And now the archaeologists see a courtyard with all of these remains. They started looking at the actual composition of the soil in which the skeletons were found, and saw that it contained a lot of runoff from the mountains that was very similar to what they were experiencing at that very time when there were all those heavy rains. And then they continued to excavate down into these courtyards, and they saw that after a period of time, the strata didn't have any of those skeletons. And then they continued to dig, and they found more layers that had, again, these skeletons, but also surrounded by this kind of sediment that was indicative of runoff. And it was just all of a sudden one of those aha moments where they said, hey, you know what probably happened here was they had the same type of El Nino, the same type of really severe weather that they were experiencing at that time, and this was a way that the Moche were trying to control the weather, control the forces of nature.
By making sacrifices.
And then when the rain stopped, the sacrifices stopped.
Mm-hmm.
But this was always something that everybody thought was kind of hearsay. When you see images on pottery, but you don't see anything that is physical to support that, it's hard to believe that it really happened. And then as this fluke of nature, lo and behold, we find that that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they went through periods of long stretches of dry, mm-hmm. and then with the El Nino about every 25 years or so.
It was even longer than that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Really? 25 to 50 years?
Maybe even 100 to 150
mm-hmm.
years.
But then the rains would come and be too severe. So it was really either a place that had too little water or at times too much water. And they say today, right, part of the problem is with the El Ninos is that they get too much water, which is why there's roofs being put on some of these places and why the bricks are turning into mud.
Right, and you know, even during the time when the El Nino happened, the last one that was really so devastating here, it washed away homes and fields, and people, you know, lost their livelihoods. And that is within the 20th century. You can imagine what it would have happened in 600 AD or BC, that people that are living in adobe houses and they had the same quantity of rains, that we saw that beautiful valley even between this temple mound and that temple, or the Huaca de la Luna, that all of that would have just been washed away. So people would have been desperate to do anything to try to appease the gods.
Yeah. And then they found it didn't help.
No.
It didn't work. All right. All right, this is just an example of other places where there were
other
different
cities. Other Moche cities.
The Moche cities, and there's a lot more huacas around too.
There are many huacas. Yeah. You know, each one of these little points here along all of these rivers represent a city.
Yeah.
A city that could have held maybe 100,000 people. So. Yeah.
So we covered a lot of ground today, and it was a great day, Terry. Nice to be out with you. Always more to see.
That's right. I'm looking forward to it next time.
We'll have to do it next time. Hey, thank you for joining us on another Jamie's Journey. Glad you came along, and hope you come travel with us again. Thank you.